I've always preferred small cars, and 8 years ago, I needed a new one. On a social media post, friend A recommended a Smart for Two, commonly known as a smart car, because he owned one and loved it. Having never seen one in person, I asked him if I could fit two people in that car and still have room for things like groceries or suitcases. Before he could respond, friend B, who I know to be trustworthy and intelligent, responded with the following. Quote, "You couldn't fit yourself in a 4-2, let alone you plus suitcase plus groceries. Buy a Honda," end quote. The big problem with friend B's advice was that he had also never actually been in a smart car. I got some contrary information from friend A, and I eventually leased a smart car for 3 years. I've now owned one for over 5 years, and I can assure you that there is, in fact, room for groceries or a few boxes or suitcases in the back. Thanks to its hatchback, I've even transported 8-foot boards and a 12-foot ladder in my smart car. Several 6-foot boards can even fit from the passenger floor to the back with the hatch closed. Strangely, that was just the first of countless experiences of people with good intentions eagerly offering me blatant smart car misinformation without ever having confirmed that information for themselves. I regularly receive commentary about my own car from other people, many of whom are complete strangers. Some like to say, tall people could never use my car. They don't know the front seat feels just as roomy as an average car. Its engine is located below the storage area in the back, which saves engine space. It makes the exterior shorter in the front, leading people to falsely assume it's small and cramped inside. And they believe in that assumption so much that they're willing to dispense advice based exclusively on that assumption. Lacking all that front engine space also causes people to assume smart cars are unsafe, especially for front-end collisions. Strangers have approached and sincerely cautioned me that it's irresponsibly unsafe to drive my car on the highway, but that's not true either. The vehicle has an overall 4-star safety rating, including 4 stars for frontal and 5 stars for side impacts. The main structure of the car is essentially designed around a solid frame built to protect its occupants, similar to a stock car roll cage. I think this problem starts with people being dangerously comfortable with their intuition and assumptions. The biggest takeaway from this exploration may be to simply not do that. There are countless truths that are counterintuitive, and if you don't have personal experience or expertise or you haven't done quality research in a field, it's probably better to ask questions than make unconfirmed claims. A vehicle is one of the most expensive things most people own. If people are willing to dispense such cavalier and uninformed advice on an issue as important as car purchasing, even if they have good intentions, how many smaller examples might there be? Let me offer another anecdotal example of this phenomenon that doesn't involve cars. Several years back, I adopted a dog from my local animal shelter where I had already been volunteering for a long time. A dog enthusiast coworker of mine assured me it was good I adopted him because that shelter would have killed him if he were there for more than 10 days. She spoke of this kill dogs after 10 days policy with such confidence that if I didn't know better from personal experience, I'd have believed her without question and probably spread that myth myself. I knew from volunteering there, however, that the dog I adopted had been there for months. I also knew that another dog at that shelter had been there for 3 years. While that shelter is considered a kill shelter, there are a lot of misconceptions around the terms kill shelter and non-kill shelter. To briefly dispel that myth, being a kill shelter simply means a place does have the staff, equipment, and ability to put down animals when needed. It doesn't mean they're in a hurry to do so. My coworker, however, bought that misconception with such conviction that she was willing to spread that misinformation casually and publicly without ever confirming it. There's another factor that may simultaneously explain both a consequence of this casual spread of misinformation and its cause. That factor is how willing people are to accept claims without vetting them. We often make the fool's gold assumption that people with good intentions must be reliable sources. Friend B from my first example would never lie to me, but he spread misinformation without a second thought. Even if we charitably interpreted his response as a joke, he was happy to disparage the purchase of a vehicle that he'd never driven. Had it not been for another trusted friend giving me contrary information from personal experience, I likely would have taken that false information as truth and never known that his advice was inaccurate. We live in a time where information can spread more rapidly than ever before. Many assume social media fact-checkers are liars, censoring the reality they coincidentally want to be true. If we want valid information to outweigh misinformation, then we need to be conscious about not creating, receiving, and/or spreading misinformation. We can do that by resisting the urge to blurt out our assumptions as facts, and by confirming the information we accept as factual hasn't come from sources that have done just that. Lastly, we all need to be especially careful not to accept or spread claims just because they confirm our ignorant misconceptions, particularly those that we want to believe, or because that particular misinformation just happens to tickle our funny bones. The most dangerous and effective kinds of misinformation and lies are the ones that you want to be true.